password cracking with default passwords. Mostly we use default password. We attacker mostly try to use first default passwords. A default password is a password supplied by the manufacturer with new equipment that is password protected. So basically when we buy the new equipment, they comes with the default password. Default passwords, it is like to for like for the plug and play feature. Like users don't know anything about that devices, so they can still use those devices with the default setting. So they come with the default settings like plug and play. You just plug the device and it will start working. So with the plug and play configurations, it configures with the default username and password also. So attacker will do what? It will try to search the online source for a default password for the device. So it will get there are lots of different sites which gives you the default password information, like what is the device, what is the manufacturer, what is the version of the device, and what are the default username and password for that particular device. So you will get this on lots of different sources of online sources. So this is one of the site where you can find the default passwords. It's like it says default password.us. I forgot my password. So what to do? So I'll go with like D-Link. I want to know D-Link passwords. So these are the D-Link devices we have here. And let's say this one. So it will show like what is the default password for this. For this device, you can see the vendor, default user, and the default password. It is also showing the price range also. So like this, we have different other sites where you can go and find out the default passwords. So default password, finding the default password is very easy. Now if you have configured your device with the default passwords, then you can be in the problem. You can be in a problem. That means attacker will try to use the default password first to connect your device. And if you have not configured the, if you have not changed the default password, then attacker can easily gain the access of your device. Then in the password cracking, we have manual password cracking. That is guessing. And this is the steps we use. First, we'll find the valid user. A valid user will be want to do the attack, which users we want to crack the password. Then we'll create a list of possible passwords, and this we will guess from doing the reconnaissance and social engineering part. So by doing those social engineering and reconnaissance part, we will come to know that what are the information, we'll come to know about the information for that particular user, and we'll try to guess the user's password. So it could be any. It could be its favorite fruit, favorite food, favorite actors, or favorite animal, dog, whatever. Or it can be any family member, date of birth. It can be a combination of email address. So we can come to know about those information by using those reconnaissance and social engineering. Then we'll try to create the list of possible passwords. That among those information, we'll try to use the information and try to create the list of possible passwords that user can have. Then next, we'll rank password from high of probability to low, that most likely the user will have this password. Then after that, I will go for the next highest rank. I will rank the passwords like for high to low. That's most probably the password will be this. Then second probably this. Third probability is this. So we'll create the list of the passwords, and with the list, in the list we'll create the password, we'll rank the password by high to low probabilities. Then what? We'll use key in which password until correct password is discovered. So we'll try to use those each passwords one by one until we reach to the right password. Now using this method, frequency of attack is very less. So attack frequency is less and the failure rate is very high, because we are just guessing it. So guessing means it is possible to have the password, or it may not get the password properly because we are just guessing it. So success rate is very low because the failure is very high. Then we can use this stealing password using the USB drive also. You can do this USB, you can use the USB drive to steal the password from the device. So what we'll do here, we'll create a USB drive which extracts the password information from user's machine. And then what we'll do, we'll use that drive to connect that machines. So when you connect the machine, when you connect the drive USB flash into the machine, it will run in the background, those softwares will run in the background and try to extract the password from that user's machine. And we'll use the auto run feature of USB drive. Remember, whenever you connect any USB flash, it do auto run. It automatically execute the flash and opens the flash automatically, and it will show the content. Now what we will do here, we will use that auto run feature to run a command, run a program to extract the password from the user's machine. So if it's possible, then we can insert the USB drive into a victim's computer and we'll grab the password from that computer. Now what we will get there, we will get the password hash, and then we can use the other techniques to crack the password from that hash. So for making that USB flash, we have one of the option. First we have to download this software which is called PassView. This is a password hacking tool. Then after downloading this, we'll copy the download files into USB drive. So we will copy this into USB drive, and under the USB drive we will create an autorun.inf file. This autorun.inf file is the responsible file to run this USB flash autorun automatically. So whenever you connect this flash in any machine, this autorun file, autorun.inf file, do what? It run those flash and execute that flash, and whatever the files are there, it shows those into our machine directly. So what we'll do here, we'll create a autorun.inf file by ourselves in the USB drive, and the syntax for that autorun.inf will be like this. Under the bracket it is autorun, and it is going to launch en is equal to launch.bat. Now this launch.bat is the batch file. It is a script file for the Windows command. So we are saying this autorun.inf file that whenever this USB flash will be connected, so it will execute the autorun and it will execute this launch.bat script. Now after this, we will create this launch.bat file, this script file, and under the script file we will give this command. The command is start to execute the exe file. Start command is to execute any exe file. Now what exe file we will execute? We will execute the exe file called pspv. This is the pspv.exe file. This is the same file we downloaded from the internet. This is what password view. Then it will run with the option s text, and it will do what? It will extract the password and save it into the text file, and then we will mention the text file name pspv.txt, whatever name you can put, and it will do what? It will execute and save the password. It will extract the password and then it will save it here in this text file. It will extract the password what we have saved into our system. That means when we logged into our system with the Microsoft account, or we log into the browser with different accounts, so it will try to extract these user and password information from browser, email clients. So whatever the applications are there where we save the passwords, it will try to extract the password from there. So what we'll do here, then we'll insert the USB drive and the autorun windows will pop up, and if enable, autorun is enabled, then autorun will execute, and autorun will execute this launch.bat file, and this launch.bat file will execute this exe file, pspvexe.exe file, with this extract s text option and it will do extract the passwords in your machine and put it into this psvv.txt file. I have downloaded that in my C drive. This is what psvv.txt, it is under the zip file, so I will extract it first. So this is the exe file we have, and we can run this exe file. It is a command line exe, so you can run it from command line. Like you have to go to cmd for this. Now I will directly run it, but we can run it from the flash. We have to create the autorun.nf file in the flash, and in that flash you have to create launch.bat so that we can execute it from there. Or I can run it from here. I will go to that directory, and this is the file which you will run with S text option. After that we will mention the text file where you want to save the password. Now remember, it is going to extract the password from Internet Explorer where you have saved the passwords. It is also going to extract the password from mail client if you have. I'm not having those clients here. But if you have those clients, then it is going to extract it from there. So what it do here, it will create this txt file with the passwords it will extract from Internet Explorer or mail clients like Outlook or any other mail clients. Now let's check the file. It created this file. When I open the file, it is empty. Now it is empty because I have not saved any password in Internet Explorer and I don't have any mail client. Now there is one more thing here. If you are having any kind of antivirus, any kind of antivirus, that means if you are having even a Windows Defender in your Windows 10 machine, those antivirus can easily detect this as a virus, this application, because it does a malicious thing. So they detect it as a malicious application and malware, and they will remove it. So if you are having any antivirus, or if the victim machine has any antivirus security available, that means it will not run. It will detect it and it will block it. So the security for this is what, the antivirus. If you are having any kind of antivirus, even a Windows Defender working properly updated, then this will not work. And if the machine is not having any security, it is vulnerable, then we can use this to get the passwords from stored password from Internet Explorer and other mail clients. Then stealing password using keyloggers. These are also very good way to get the steal the passwords from victim's machine. Now keyloggers provides an easiest and most effective means of stealing all victims' user names and passwords. If an attacker is successful in infecting a victim's machine with a trojan that have keylogging feature, he can instruct the trojan server to log and send back all user credentials to his machine. So what attackers do here, they try to install the trojan horses in the victim machine. Now for installing these trojan viruses in the victim's machine, they can use the different techniques of social engineering. So by using those social engineering techniques, they can install the trojan viruses into the victim machine. And if it is installed there, and if that trojan horse has the keylogging feature available, then it can do what? It can use that, attacker can use that key logging feature to extract the user's credential and other information from the victim machines. So very simple, first user will do what? It will use the Trojan horses to install into the victim machine, and when the victim machine is installed with the Trojan horses, it will reply with the response with the attacker machine that I am now available. Now attacker will do what? It will instruct the victim machine to start key logging. Now when the key logging is started in the victim machine, now victim does not know what is happening in the background, because those Trojan horses or these key loggers works in the background. They don't show up itself, it works in a background, and when the user and victim try to log into any other server to get the work, or suppose it logs into the domain server. So when it logs into the domain server, it will use its own credential. Now when it use the credential, it will type the credential from the keyboard. So keyboard, that means it will use the keyboard to type the username and password. Now when it use the keyboard, so key loggers do what? It will log all the keystrokes which user give, and it will log all the keystrokes in the sequence also, and then it will get what? Whatever you type, it will get what? It will send that to the attacker, and then what? Attacker can use this to log into the server by using your credentials, by the victim's credentials. Now Microsoft authentication. Now we'll come to Microsoft authentication. How Microsoft authenticate? How Microsoft authenticate users? Now in Microsoft we have two options. We have a local environment, which is work group, where authentications will happen in the local machine, and we have the other environment, which is domain environment. In a domain environment, authentication happens on domain controller. So we have workgroup environment where the authentication happens in the local environment, local machine, and the domain environment where authentication happens on the domain machine, domain controller. Now how authentication happens? First, you want to log into the Windows machine, then what you do, you provide username and password, or any other machine, like you want to log into Windows machine or Linux machine or any other operating system. What you do, you provide username and password, then machine will do what? It will authenticate yourself, that whether you are providing the right credential or not right credential, right credential or wrong credential. Now how the machine knows that your credential is right or wrong? So when you give any password or any username, machine knows that you are giving right username or password, because machine has a database of that username and passwords. So machine has a database where it has stored all the username and password which is allowed to access the machine. So when user try to access the machine, it will provide the username and password which is authenticated. So when it provides the username and password, so machine will do what? It will match the username and the password hash with the password hash which is stored into the local machine. Now when you are having a local machine and your credential is locally stored, so if you are in a workgroup environment, so your machines, your passwords or your credentials, your username and passwords will be stored into the local system, in a local machine. In the local machine, that means in Windows machine, there is a file, it is called SAM file. It is called SAM database. SAM means S-A-M. That means Security Account Manager. It is Security Account Manager database. So Windows stores users' passwords in the Security Account Manager database, it is called SAM, or in the Active Directory database in domain environment. So if you are having a domain environment, then your passwords will not store into the local system. your username and passwords will be stored into the domain controller in the Active Directory database. So passwords are never stored in clear text. Remember, passwords are never stored in a clear text form. It always has a hash. So passwords are hashed and the results are stored into the system, into the SAM file. That means they use the hashing algorithm to convert the normal password into hash password. So suppose when you create a user and you create the password for the user. Suppose I give a password, I create the password for the user is ABC. So what machine will do? It will take that ABC and then it will use an hashing algorithm and then it will hash the ABC password. Then whatever the result come, it will store that result into the SAM file. That this is a username. Username will be in clear text. And for the password, it has that hash stored. Now, when that user comes and try to log into the system, so user will provide that username and then it will provide the password. So if it is giving password ABC, so what machine do? Machine will use the same hashing algorithm to hash that password which user provide. And then whatever the result comes, it will try to match the result with the SAM file. So if the result is same as the SAM file, that means the hash which is stored into the SAM file. So if both are same, that means users are giving right password and the machine authenticate the user. If the password is not same, if the hash is not matched, then machine will say that this is not a right password you are providing. So machine knows that you are giving right or wrong password because it has a database where it is stored the password, but it is not in a clear text. It is in a SAM. It is in a hash format. So it is in a SAM file when you are having a local machine, and if you are having a domain environment, then your password will be stored into the domain controller. But even in the domain controller also, it is not a clear text password. It is again hashed password. Now for hashing the password, what Microsoft use the hashing algorithm. It use LM and NTLM. Now NTLM authentication. This NTLM authentication is a protocol. NTLM is actually a protocol, authentication protocol. So this NTLM protocol, authentication protocol types, this NTLM authentication protocol or LM authentication protocol. These protocol stores user's password in the SAM database using different hashing methods. Now LM means line manager and NTLM means new technology line manager. Now we have Kerberos. Kerberos is the Microsoft. Now Microsoft has upgraded its default authentication protocol to Kerberos, which provides a stronger authentication for client server application than NTLM. Now when there was a local authentication, then it was done based on LM and NTLM protocols. But when we have domain environment, then previously, prior than 2003 servers, before the 2003 servers, there was NTLM version 2 protocol, authentication protocol was used to authenticate the users from domain environment. But after 2003 servers, after Windows Server 2003 server, Windows has changed the default authentication protocol from NTLM version 2 to Kerberos. So now the Kerberos is the authentication protocol for Windows in domain environment. But in a local environment, it is still uses the same SAM file for authentication. And in the SAM file, it is still uses the NTLM or LM password hashes. So how hash passwords are stored in Windows SAM file? So if you open the SAM file, now where you will find the SAM file? Let me show you the SAM file first. Now, SAM file you will find under C drive. You will go to Windows, and under the Windows, you have System 32, Now under system32 you have config directory. So when you go to config directory, you will see this SAM file. So this is the SAM file you have, and all the local users' passwords, local machines' username and passwords are stored into this SAM file. Now if you want to open the file here, so when you double click it, first of all, it is not having any extension. So when you double click on it, so it will say that which application you want to open this file. So I will say Notepad. Now remember, I try to open the file in Notepad. Now you will get this option, you will get this information warning. What it is saying here, the process cannot access the file because it is being used by the another process. So basically you cannot open the file. So you cannot open the file. If you want to see the file, you can't open it in Windows. Now why you can't open it? Because it is saying that the some other process is already using it. It is already used by some other process. So what we can do here, if suppose I use this hard disk to connect into other machine as a secondary hard disk, and then I will try to open this same file. So at that time maybe it can open. And when we open it, we can see that file and we can see the passwords of usernames and passwords. But again, it is not in a clear text. There is one more directory. So when you open the SAM file, so even if you open the SAM file, so it looks like this. So it looks like this, where you see the username and the passwords hash there. So when you open the file, you will see here the username first, then you will see the UID. This is the UID which is, we can say, under the this is the last part of the SID we have seen. The SID is the combination of the domain, subdomain, OU and other informations, and then the last part is the UID. So this is the UID of the user, and then it shows the LM hash first, and then it shows the NTLM hash. Now LM and NTLM hash, the LM hash is more weak, it is weaker than NTLM. LM hashes are more weaker than NTLM hash. NTLM hash is more secure than LM hash. But you can see this here. If you see the LM hash, you will see here, and NTLM hash you will see here. But nowadays in new machines, new Microsoft machine, you will not see LM hash. Now LM hashes are disabled. LM hashes have been disabled in Windows Vista and later Windows operating system. LM will be blank in those systems. So in those systems, when you try to extract the SAM file, when you check the SAM file, you will see the blank part here under the LM hash. You will see only the NTLM hash. So when you log in, when you give the username and password, then machine do what? It will convert your login credential into the hash, and then it will try to match the hash with the stored hash. And if the hash matches, then it will allow you to log in. And if the hash is not matches, then it will not allow you to log in. But nowadays no LM hash is available, only NTLM hash is available in Windows new machines. In older machines you can see the LM hashes. Now why they have disabled the LM hash? Because LM hash was weak. It was weak algorithm, and it uses the weak algorithm to hash the password. So what is LAN manager hash? That is LM hash. So LM hash or a LAN manager hash is the primary hash format that Microsoft LAN manager and Microsoft Windows use to store user passwords of up to 14 character length. So first problem with the LM hash is it can store only 14 characters of password. Then when this password is encrypted with LM algorithm, all the letters are converted to uppercase. So when LM hash uses to encrypt the password, hashes the password, so it do what? Whatever passwords you provide, it will convert the password into uppercase. Then the password is padded with the null, that is blank characters, to up to make it 14 characters in the length. Now remember, it accepts 14 character password. So if suppose you give only 3 character password, like I give ABC, so what it will do, it will add the remaining part blank. It will add the null blank hash for the remaining part. So it will be easy for the administrator, it will be easy for the user, it will be easy for the attacker to guess how long the password is and how much I have to crack. Then before encrypting this password, 14 character string is split in half and each string is individually encrypted and the result concatenated. That means whatever the password you give, so first it will do what? It will add rest of the password. Like if you give only 3 letters ABC, then rest of the words it will add random numbers of 14 characters. Actually it uses the null blank character. Then what it do, null blank character, that means it will be same for every password which is lesser than 7 characters. Why? Because it divides this 14 into 2 parts of 7, and then it will separately encrypt those password, those 7 characters password. So if your first password is within the 7 character, then the rest of the 7 password will always be the same. So when you see the two passwords, suppose you have two passwords, one password is ABC, other password is 123. So it will be, after using the LM hash, both passwords, half of the password hash will be same for both the passwords, because half of the password for the both password is using the null password, null characters. And null characters, when they encrypt the null characters with the LM hash, then it will get the same value. So attackers do what? If they see the LM hash, so if the LM hash, it shows the null character hash, the null character after 7, like half of the characters of the half of the hash value is same, then same for the null blank, then attacker can easily say that the password is less than 7 character. Now it is what, attacker don't have to attack on the whole hash value, it just have to attack the half of the hash value. That means it just have to crack the value 7 characters, don't have to crack the whole 14 character. So it is easy for the attacker to use the cracking tool only for the 7 characters instead of 14 characters. And that is why this LM has been disabled from Windows Vista and later operating system of Windows. Now what NTLM do? NTLM hash, when you see the NTLM hash, when you see this here, this is the LM hash. Now if you see here, this Jason Smith, they both have the same LM password hash. You can see the LM hash is same for both the users because they are having the same password. Maybe they are having same password like ABC, ABC, and rest of the half of the password hash is blank character. So blank characters always be the same. And you will not, and you will never use 14 character password. But when you go for the LM NTLM hash, now NTLM hash will do what? It actually uses the same way as the LM hash, but it does not divide it into 7 part of 7 characters. It will encrypt the whole characters once. Like if you are using only ABC as a password, then it will pad the password with other characters to up to 14. But when it comes to encrypt the password, it will not encrypt separately, it will encrypt it with together. So if you are using the same, if you are using less than 7 character password, then again still the hashes of two passwords will never be the same. So attacker will not able to guess that there is the null characters at the end of the password. So I don't have to attack only the I don't have to attack the whole 14 character, I just have to attack only the 7 character. But in NTLM, it is not like that. So attacker has to attack on all the 14 character password hash, that the whole password hash, it has to be attacked. So LM hashes are easy to crack, but NTLM hashes are not that easy to crack. Now, in a domain environment, how the NTLM authentication process works. Now remember, this was available before 2003 servers, but after 2003 servers, Microsoft is using Kerberos authentication for domain environment. Now still, if you find somewhere old versions of Windows Server, then you can see this NTLM authentication process. Now what happened here, when you are in the domain, then your password authentication will not happen in the local machine. Your authentication will happen on the domain controller. So domain controller, that means the controller, the machine which is installed with the domain Windows Server operating system. So how it works here, first when the user logs into the client machine, so what user do, user types the password into login window. It pass the username and password into the login window. Then what this client machine do, what the client computer do, it hashes the password with the algorithm, with the hash algorithm, LM or NTLM. It hashes with both the algorithms, like because it is the old version of Windows, so it uses both the algorithms. So it do what, it hashes the password with both the algorithms, LM and NTLM hashes. So Windows run password through the hashing algorithm and it generates the password hash. Now remember, it will not hash the username, because username will be used to identify the user, and then domain controller can check the password hash for that user. So username will be in clear text and the password will be hashed with the hashing algorithm. Then after hashing it, what the computer will do, the client computer will do what, it will send the login request to domain controller. It will send the login request to domain controller. Now domain controller do what, domain controller sends the challenge. So domain controller sends the challenge, it could be any random characters. Then our computer, the client computer, responds to the challenge. It responds to the challenge and it do what, it the DC computer's response with the response it creates with its own hash, and if the match, the logon is successful. So what it do here, when the user client machine sends a request for the domain controller, so domain controller sends the challenge, it sends the random characters for the client. Now client machine do what, it hashes these characters, it encrypts this character with the hash of his password. So the hash of the password, it will use that hash of the password to encrypt these characters and send the response to the domain controller. Now the domain controller has also the same password hash. It also has the same password hash stored into the database in the domain controller. So what it will use, it will try to use the same hash to decrypt the response. It will try to decrypt the response which is already sent by the domain controller here. So it will try to decrypt it, and if it is decrypted, then the password is right. That means if this value is decrypted, and if it is only decrypted when the password hash is same, which is used to encrypt the password and which is used to decrypt the password. So if the password hash is same, then this random characters can be decrypted by the domain controller, and if it is decrypted, then domain controller says that you are authenticated and the login is successful. And if it is not decrypted, then the login is not successful and you will get the error. Now it is a little complex method. Here what is happening here, the hashes are not going from client machine to server machine. Remember, the password hash are not going from client machine to server machine. It is remaining there in the client machine. It is only sending this encrypted value to the server, and server try to decrypt the same value by using its own password hash, which is stored into the database. So by this NTLM authentication process, what happened? The password hashes are not going into the wire. So if any attacker try to sniff the password hashes from the wire, then it is not possible for him to sniff the password, because password hashes are not going on the wire. It is only this random character value is encrypted. It is this random character values is going from server to client and client to server. So it is encrypting. The client is encrypting the value with the hash, and then server is decrypting value with the same hash. It is stored. But now Windows is not using this NTLM authentication process for Windows domain environment. Now it is using Kerberos. So Microsoft has upgraded its default authentication protocol to Kerberos, which provides strong authentication for client-server application than NTLM. Now how Kerberos works? So Kerberos authentication. Now how Kerberos authentication works? Now this Kerberos, first this Kerberos protocol is not developed by Microsoft. So it is not a proprietary for Microsoft. You can have this authentication protocol available in other operating systems also. You can configure it in Windows, you can configure it in Linux machines also. So it is not a proprietary for Windows, but Windows is now using this. This is as a default authentication for its Windows server environment, in the domain environment. Now how it works? In this Kerberos authentication, we have key distribution center. It is called KDC. Now under the KDC, we have these three things. First, authentication server, then ticket generating server, and then database of username and password. Now these three things we have in KDC. Now remember, it is not developed by Windows, so we can have different servers for these different things. We can have a different server for authentication, we can have a different server for ticket generating server, and we can even have a database, a separate database for the authentication information. So if suppose you are configuring it in another environment, like other than Windows, then you can have different server for authentication, you can have different server for ticket generation, you can have different server for database. But in Windows environment, these all things are the job of Windows domain controller. This everything is done by Windows domain controller, and it is the KDC server. So key distribution center server is the domain controller itself. No other server is there to do this. But authentication done like this. First, client machine comes and it will try to log in to the domain. So it will provide the authentication request. So first, user sends the authentication request to server. Now user request for authentication goes to the authentication server first, AS. Now remember, the same server, this server is the same server, this is the same domain controller. So first the request goes to the domain controller server as a authentication server. Now the authentication server replies to the user request. It will reply to the user request, and it says that how I am going to authenticate you. It gives the information that how I am going to authenticate you. So it do what? When user logs in, it provides the username and password, and its username and password goes to the authentication server. Now authentication server will check the database and try to match the username and the password hash which is coming from the client. So if the database has the username and the hash for that username is stored, and if it matches the hash which is sent by the username, which is sent by the client, that means what? The user is authenticated. So authentication server's job is to authenticate the user. That means this is the user which is authenticated by the server. That means it is authenticated to use the resources of the domain and the server. So in a reply from the authentication server, it will send a token. It actually sends a token to the client. Then the client machine send this token to ticket generating server. This is like request to the TGC for the service ticket. So it sends the token to ticket generating server, TGS server. Now again in Windows environment, this TGS is the same domain controller, which is the same authentication server, which is the same server which is having the user database. But it can be a different server in other environment. Now it sends the request to ticket. It sends a request for the service ticket. Now the service ticket means what? In the authentication server, it gives the token to the client machine that I am authenticating you. Now when it sends a request to the TGS server, it sends the token to that TGS server. Now TGS server checks the token. The token checks in the database. It checks the database that whether this user is authenticated by the authentication server or not. Now if the user is authenticated by the authentication server, it will find the record in authentication server that this user is already authenticated. And it gets this by using the token provided by the client, and that token is given by the authentication server. Now when the authentication server, the ticket generating server, says that okay, you are authenticated already, and it verifies that from the authentication server by using the token, what it will do here, the ticket generating server in a reply of that request send that service ticket to the client machine. Now the service ticket is a ticket for the client to use the resources of the domain for the period of time. Now remember the period of time which is defined in the policy of Kerberos. This is the policy. The policy of the Kerberos is by default have the ticket, that lifetime for the ticket is 10 hours. We can change that from the policy. We can change it from the policy, domain security policy. We can change the Kerberos policy. And we can change the lifetime of that service ticket. By default, the time of the service ticket is valid for 10 hours. So the ticket, this service ticket goes to the client, and then it will store into the client machine, and it will remain there until the client logs out. Or if the client is not logs out, then after the 10 hours, the ticket will be invalid. Remember that service ticket validity time is 10 hours by default, and it will remain in the client machine's memory until user logs out. If the user logs out, the ticket will be invalid, and if the user does not log out, the ticket will be invalid after 10 hours. So 10 hours is enough time. Like you work for 8 hours, and more than 8 hours you go for 2 hours more. So that 10 hours is the by default hours for the service ticket validity. Then after 10 hours it will be invalid automatically. Now if you logged in more than 10 hours, then you will see a window error in the notification center. You will see the error saying your service ticket is expired, please re-log in. Now what happens if your service ticket is in expire? When your service ticket is expired, that means you are not able to use the resources of domain. Now how you will use the resources of the domain? For example, there is an application server there, and you want to use the application of that server. For example, it is a web server, it is FTP server, it is SQL server, or any other kind of server available in the domain. Now user wants to use that server's application. So first user will do what? User will send the request to connect that application server. Now when user sends the request, user's client machine, client machine will send the service ticket also. The service ticket which it gets from the TGS server. So it sends its service ticket with the request for connecting the application. Now the application server sees the service ticket, and then the application server, this application server will validate the ticket from the KDC. It will send the request to the KDC for validation of that service ticket. Now remember, when the user logs in, the database has the information about that user, that this user logs in from this time and it can log down to this time for next 10 hours. Now the application server try to validate it from the KDC server. Now if the KDC server says that this user is validate and it is authenticated, then only the application server will allow it to access the application. Otherwise, if suppose that TG, that service ticket is expired, it is expired after 10 hours. So what happened? the JDC server will say to application server that this user ticket, this service ticket is already expired. That means this user is no longer able to use this application. So if your service ticket is valid, then you can use any resources in the domain. And if the service ticket is not valid, then it is not able, the user is not able to use any services from the domain. Now, when it is authenticated by the KDC, that application server authenticated the user from the KDC, that is it the valid user for the period of time, then this application server itself send the session ticket to client, to the user. That session ticket will remain valid for next 600 minutes. So it is going to valid for next 600 minutes. This is the default time. And this time also we can change from the Kerberos policy. Kerberos policy of domain controller in the domain security policy. So next 600 minutes, that user can use this application, that application from the domain. Now after 600 minutes, the service ticket, that session ticket will also expire, and then again user has to regenerate the ticket. So this is how this authentication works, this Kerberos authentication works. Very simple. If you see this, like you go to for example, you go to a theater to watch a movie. So what happened there, you buy the ticket first. That means you buy the ticket, like you are validated to enter the theater. That means you are getting the ticket from the authentication server. Now when you try to enter the theater, you will provide the ticket to the get main, that is the TGS. Now TGS will do what? It will take the half of the ticket and give you the half of the ticket, and that ticket is your service ticket, valid for next 3 hours, the time of the movie. So the time of the movie, you are valid for that movie, you can see the movie. Now one more thing, if suppose you are getting some offer on that ticket, like you can get some popcorns free with that ticket. So what you will do, you will go to the shop, popcorn shop, and you will provide the ticket. Now if the ticket is valid for the time for that show, then only you will get the free popcorn. Otherwise you will not get the free popcorn, right? So we can assume it like this. So this process is like, we can say it is designed like assuming those things. So this Kerberos authentication works like that. By now Windows uses this Kerberos to authenticate in domain environment. Now one more thing, it is called password salting. This password salting techniques prevents driving passwords from password files. Stored representation differs, and advantage is what? Defeats pre-computed hash attack. So actually what this password salting is, when the machine stores the password in the Windows in the machine, so what it do, machine hashes the password. Now machine can do what? It can do one more thing. It can do salt on the hashing algorithm. It can use the salting technique on the hashing algorithm. And what it will do, it will generate the different password for the same value. It will use what? A different passwords for the same value. Now this salting technique is not used in Windows machine. In Windows machine, it uses same LM and NTLM hashes. So if suppose two user has the same password, so you will see the same hash for both the users in Windows environment, in Windows machine. So if suppose one user is having a password ABC, so other user is also having the password ABC, when you see the hash of both the user, that will be the same hash. So if you crack one hash, that means other hash is also same, that means the password is same. But when you have a salting technique, then what you will get the different password of the same value. If you are having same password ABC, if you are using same ABC password for multiple users, but still the hash of those passwords will be different because of salting. In a Linux machine, it uses a salting technique to store the password, not in the Windows machine. Now what it do here actually, it uses the predefined values. It knows, the machine knows what values it is using to hash a particular value. So when it reverses the hash, when it compare the hash, then also use the same value. For example, let me be clear this. So what happen in Windows, it uses the LM hash. Now what LM hash do? It suppose only 14 characters maximum, and it always want 14 characters. So if suppose you give password A and B and C, now it is not 14 character. So what Windows do, it will add null characters. It will add 14 null characters. Null characters, that means blank, 14 blank characters. Now what it do here, when it hashes the value, it divide these two parts of 7 characters. Now remember, only this first part has the password and other part does not have any value. It is null character. Then what, it hashes these values separately. It hashes these values separately, that means separately these 7 characters and other 7 characters separately. Then whatever the value comes, for example, this ABC will become 1, 2, 3, and this null character. Now null character, when you use the same algorithm, it will always be the same. So whenever you see that same value, for example, I will say X, Y and Z. So for example, this is the null value this is the null values hash. Whenever you hash the null value, you will always get the same value. Now that means what, whenever attacker sees this value at the end of the password hash, then attacker easily know that this password is less than 7 character, and it only works for this 7 characters to crack. Now if you are having NTLM password hash, now NTLM is the new technology, it do the same thing, but only the difference it has a small difference here. Now what it do here, it also support 14 characters. It also support 14 characters. So if you give any password here, like ABC I am giving here, so again what it will do, it will fill the other values, other characters up to 14 with the null character. Now null character means what? No characters. Now the difference here is, it will not do separate, it will not separate the 7 characters, it will directly hash the whole 14 character with the null character. And whatever the value comes, it will store into the hash. So we cannot guess that the other half part is the null character. So attacker is not able to guess that the password is less than 7 character. Now attacker has to work on the whole 14 character value. So it is getting the job difficult for the attacker. But whether you are using NTLM or NM hash, what happens if you use the same password ABC for multiple users, the hash value will always be the same. It will always be the same value, because you are using the same hashing algorithm, and also NTLM uses more hash, the more extra bit, like it is using not it uses what LM uses 64 bit to 128 bit. So 64 bit for the 7 characters, 64 bit for the 7 character for the encryption. So 64 bit and 64 bit is total 128 bit, but because the half of the character is null, attacker only has to work on 64 bit. So it reduces the job to half, but in NTLM it do what, it uses 128 bit together. So as the bit increases, the possibility will also increase. Remember, as the bit increase, the possibility for the password will also increase. So if you try to guess the password, so you have to calculate 2 raised to 128 possibilities. Remember, 2 raised to 128 possibilities you have to calculate. You have to guess. And if you are having only 64, then you have to just guess 2 raised to 64 possibilities. So this is less than NTLM. So LM hash is weak. So that is why now LM hashes are not available in any new machines. You will get only NTLM hash. Now what salting do? Salting use the different technology. What different technique? What it do here? Suppose I give the password A, B, C, or 1, 2, 3. Now, if you use LM or NTLM, so what it will do? It will use the same hashing algorithm, whether it is using DES, triple DES. These are the hashing encrypting algorithm. Hashing algorithm MD4, MD5, or SHA, SHA 128, SHA 256, 512 bit, whatever. If it is uses the same algorithm, so when it gets the value, it always be the same. For example, we get the value X, Y, Z, and 5, 8, and 7. This is, I'm just giving example, but the hash value is bigger than this. So if you use the same algorithm to hash the value, so it will generate the same hash value. Now if you use the same password for multiple users, so you will see the same hash value for all the users. Now when you use the salting technique, so what salting technique do? It will add some extra value, extra character in between. So suppose you use this ABC password, ABC 123. Now remember, this salting is done by the machine, done by the operating system. It is not done by ourselves. We don't do this. It is done by the operating system. So what operating system do here? It first put the salt here on the password which you give. So suppose I give this, I configure this password. So what machine, our machine do, our operating system do? It put salt into it. Now what salting means? It will put some extra character. Like I will say, after two characters, it put hash. Then after one character, it put zero. Now what it is putting here? It is putting this extra characters in between the value. And then after that, after salting it, then it will do what? It will hash the password. And then whatever the value it comes, for example, the value comes like X, W, E, 5, 9, 3. So this is the hash value comes after putting the salt and then hashing it with the hashing algorithm. Now what happened? Machine knows what it did. Machine knows the technique, that how it salted the password. So machine knows that after every two character I put hash, and then after one character I put zero. So machine knows that what it has done. So when you try to log in, now remember, we don't know what the machine has done. So what, when we try to log in, so what we'll do, we'll provide the same password A, B, C, and 1, and 2, and 3. Now whether you put any password, so the machine will do what? Machine will do what? Machine take your password first. When you try to log in, you provide this password. and machine has this password stored here. So machine take your password, and then remember, machine knows what is the salting technique it has used. So it will use the salting technique again. And what is the salting technique? After every two character, the salt has, it has put this extra character here. Then after one character, it has put one extra character. And then what it do? It hashes the value. And when it uses the same algorithm, it will come up with the same result. So the result will be the same, x w e 593, and then what machine do? It will try to match this password with the password which is stored into the database. And if it is matches, then it will allow the user to log in. And if it is not matches, then it will say deny, you can't log in. Now, whatever password you provide, like you give ABC at ABC123, XYZ123, 123456, it will use the same salting technique for creating the hash, which it has used to generate the hash at the time of password creation. So by using the salting, what is the benefit? Remember, in LM or NTLM hash, if you are using the same password for multiple users, you will come up with the same hash value. Like if you use ABC password for two users, the password hash will be same. But with using the salting technique, if you use the same password ABC for two users, but the hash value will be different for those two users. It will not be the same. So it will save you from the pre-computed hash attack, where attacker has generated the hash previously, and then it will try to use those hash value to match the hash from the password file. So when attacker gets the hash, suppose attacker get this hash from your system, now attacker wants to crack this hash. So it will take time to crack. It will take time because what it has to do? It has to first take the word, then convert it into hash, and then after converting into hash, then it has to match it with your hash which it gets from your system. If it is matches, then it will be the password. If it is not matches, then it is not the password. Now for saving the time, what attacker do? It will use the pre-computed hash files. It will use the Rambo table. So what it do? It will use the whole word first. It will take the whole word, all the words first, and generate the hash file, Rambo table file, where it has only hashes. Now it does not have to take each and every word separately. It will use this hash directly to compare with this hash. So it will use one by one all the hashes and try to match with this hash. Now if any hashes match, then it will see what is the real value of that hash, and then it can see the password of that hash. It can crack that hash. Now if you are using the salting technique, now even if it uses the same password, suppose the password is ABC123, if it is using the same password and try to match the hash, it will not match. Because of the salt, this hash is different. It is not the same because it is having a salting technique. So it will not match with the pre-computed hash. But Windows does not use this salting technique. So Windows password hashes are not salted. It uses normal LM and NTLM hash. But other operating system like Linux, it uses the salting technique to encrypt the passwords, to hash the passwords. Now, how we can extract the password from Windows machine? So for extracting the password from the Windows machine, we can use these two tools, pwdump7 and fgdump. Fgdump works like pwdump, but also extracts cached credentials and allows remote network execution also. and pwdump extracts lm and ntlm password hashes of local user accounts from the security account manager database, and this tool must be run under an administrative account. So we can use this tool to execute on the machine, on the server machine or the local machine, to extract the password stored into that machine. Like if it is a local machine, so it will extract the passwords from local SAM file, and if it is in the Active Directory database, so it can extract the passwords from Active Directory database also. Now this fgdump we can run from the network also. We can use it to execute from the network also, but if you are using it from the network, then you have to use it with the privilege. You have to use it with the administrative privilege. You have to provide the username and password. If you are running it locally, again you need an administrative privilege to run these tools, and then you can run this tool and you can get the password. You can extract the password from Windows machine. So I'll show you this, how it extract the password from the file. Now this is my Windows 10 machine. I am running the CMD here as an administrator. Now I have the tool available here in this C drive, pwdump. So this is the tool we have here, and this tool is the exe file, and you need one DLL file for it. Now we will execute this to extract the password from this local machine. So how we'll do this, you just have to execute it. We'll go to the directory, and this is what the file. So you just have to execute it to extract the passwords from this local file. And here you can see it has extracted the passwords from the local file. And you can see this is the username, and this is the UID, this is what the LM hash, and this is the NTLM hash. So we can see the LM hash, and also we can see the NTLM hash. Now this is the file, this is administrator name, UID, LM and NTLM hash. It is extracting and dumping on directly this terminal. If I want to save it, so I will redirect the output to a file. Now it is redirected into the file, and the file is here, this file. And here we can see the usernames, UIDs and the hash values. Now fgdump can extract the password from remote location also. Now this is pwdump, this is not fgdump, and I don't have fgdump also. So you can run it locally. Now for running it remotely, you need administrative username and password for running it from remote location. So what attacker do here, attacker can use this to use it into the flash also, like we use the PSPV software. So instead of PSPV, it can run this pwdump. So it will create a flash, and in the flash it will create an auto run for this pwdump, and will put the flash in the machine which machine's password it want to extract. So when it runs the auto run, it will run this pwdump and it will extract the password from that machine. And then user, the attacker will take the password, it will generate the password under the this file, which is under the same flash of the user, the attacker. Then attacker will go into his own machine, and then it will try to use the other hashing, the cracking techniques to crack the password, crack that hash. So by using this pwdump or fgdump, attacker can extract the password from the user computer. For running it on the target machine, attacker can use different multiple techniques. It can use the Trojan technique, it can use these USB technique to create a auto run USB, and auto run USB will run this pwdump or fgdump to extract the password from the local machine and put it into the flash, and then it can take away with the flash and can crack the password with these other tools. So it can run this to extract the password from the user machine, and then it will use the other tools to extract the password from it. Now how we will try to use the other tools, and that you will see next time, that how we can use the other tool to crack this hashing, these hash values.